want to take a percentage of what you make in any concert, whether they find the concert for you or not. If we find the concert, then they're going to want a percentage. And that's where a lot of our problems came, where we decided, well, we're not going to do that. We're going, because a lot of times they're not looking for concerts for you, and you're just sitting around waiting for them to look for concerts. And as a result, you're not playing concerts unless you're looking for them yourself, spending your time, and then they're making the money that you've been investing time on. And that brings us maybe just to soliciting for concerts. And that's where you have to have a really thick skin, because you have to be on the phone, you have to be writing emails and letters, basically, I hate to say this, begging for people. You don't put it that way, but it's almost like you're begging. You call up and say, I have this great ensemble. I would wonder if you might be interested in putting it on your chamber music series. Well, then they'll ask what kind of an ensemble you have. And if you say it's a horn quartet, and immediately you can see their eyes kind of, you know, totally doing that on our brother. So if you can at least get them, even if it's not a horn quartet, it might be a brass quintet, it might be a woodwind quintet, it might be some unusual ensemble, at least get them to accept the fact that they'll listen to your demo CD, which you have to make, and a press packet that you have to put together. Now, a press packet is easy to put together these days because the software is readily available, but you have to make it concise, easy to listen, easy to read. The demo CD has to be, you have to have your best pieces, 2 or 3 minutes of each, so you really knock them out when you send it in there. And once they get it, then you have to call them up again and say, did you get the press packet? Have you been able to listen to it? And they'll go, well, no, not yet. And then you call them up another one. Basically, you are a nag. And that can be to your advantage or it might be to your disadvantage. But at least you're on there, you're pushing them. Because a lot of times they'll finally go, okay, I'll listen to it. I'll see what I can do. Sometimes after you establish a little bit of a reputation, people will call you up and say, can you play this concert? And that way, you can start building tours or concerts, little tours around that. If you have one concert that basically pays all of your expenses, then you can start building tours around that. Because what we have found is you have to realize, I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself though, for tours, you have to at least break even in the beginning. And later on, you have to at least make a little bit of a profit because, you know, you're spending a lot of time working. And so you need to be able to put food on your table and realize that what you're doing is turning some sort of a profit. Now, when you finally get a concert, a lot of people will ask for contracts. Some people will not ask for contracts, and you have to take the risk then of either you know the person and they're going to be upright and say, this is the money we'll pay you, and there'll be no problem. Now, we've had a few problems where in the end we didn't receive what we were promised. We had no contract, and I think even if we did have a contract, it wouldn't have done any good. But it's always good in those cases just to say, have a piece of paper and say, this is the contract that we have, and have both parties sign it. It doesn't have to be complicated. It just says we agree to play on a certain time, at a certain hour, and these are the materials we need. And if there are circumstances where the weather is so bad that we can't get there, then no money will be paid, but the concert will be rescheduled at a different time. So it just needs to be very basic and concise. Now, another way to get concerts is by finding grants. We applied for the National Endowment of the Arts about a little over 10 years ago and received a grant, but the paperwork involved for any government grant is huge. You have to document everything you've done before the grant, and you have to document any school concerts. They love school concerts, anything educational. And I think these days that's about the only way that you can get any grant is if you're doing something in the schools for elementary school, middle school, high school. That's what they want to see. But not only do you have to document everything before you apply for the grant, if you do get the grant, you have to document everything you do while you're doing the grant, and then you have to write a follow-up. So the paperwork involved is immense. And you have to realize that you'll be spending hours and hours and hours doing things like this.
Like telling how many tickets were sold for any particular given concert. I mean, the details that they ask for are sometimes...
Right. And what I wanted to say before is the reason this ensemble works well is because each one of us has taken the effort to do something productive in promoting the group. I've been in other chamber ensembles, and I'm sure these guys have, where one person will be excited about doing the ensemble and ends up doing all the work, and everybody else just wants to play the concerts and get paid. Well, in the end, that one person is going to get pretty either frustrated, tired, or just say, forget it, I can't do this anymore. If you spread everything out, in other words, if you have a person that delegates the work, then you're going to survive a lot longer than if just one person does everything and expects everything to be done. So when you're finding your members, before they agree to become a member, you ought to have an understanding that says, okay, in this agreement, not only are you going to be in the ensemble, but you're in charge of whatever it is, looking for work or looking for music or all sorts of things.
We've been doing this for years now. We had CDs made up, and over the years we've produced actually 8 CDs. The 9th one is right now in the pipe. We need to do the editing for it. We've had T-shirts done up. We've had stickers. We've had posters. We've got lots of different music. And these are all kind of things that we always make sure we have with us when we do go on tour, because we realize that hopefully if we make the kids that we play for, the audiences that we play for, are excited about what we've done, they're obviously going to want to have access to these other things that we have. One of those things you have to plan for, and sometimes unexpected. There are other tours we've had where we've had so much stuff left over we didn't quite know what to do with it. We ended up mailing it back because that's cheaper than paying the extra baggage fees when you try and take it back with you on the airplane.
Actually, the logistics of that has been very difficult because a lot of times we have our store of CDs in Florida or up at Kim Pope's place up in Boston, and we have to ask in advance that they ship these certain amount of CDs or merchandise to where we're going to be playing in 4 or 5 months from now. And so it takes a lot of planning and upkeep in your mind of where all your stuff is.
Yeah, that's been something that's been largely part of my responsibilities. As Charlie and David both mentioned, when you're forming an ensemble, you should be looking for people who are willing to do certain kinds of jobs because there's so many different aspects to running a successful ensemble. Right now, actually with Ken Pope in Boston, who's actually a horn repair guy, has a big shop up there. He's been very helpful because he has fortunately a lot of space to store stuff like stacks of music and boxes of CDs. But like Gary mentioned, it's a matter of organizing it. And I would have loved, when I saw how many people were showing up at the concert last night, I thought, boy, we should have had another load of CDs just sent to us from Boston. It wouldn't have cost that much. And we probably would have been able to sell probably another 50, 60 CDs, which we didn't know about. The music you have to plan too. You have to sort of figure out, well, when you come to a school like this, it's not just horn quartet stuff, because I'm sure a lot of you have brass quintets and other ensembles for which you'd be interested in looking at music. And the music that we have with us, generally speaking, that we offer to our listeners isn't just horn quartet. We've got horn octets, we've got brass quintets and stuff like that too. But again, it's also a situation of, well, what do you think they're going to be most interested in buying, and getting that organized so that either we have room in our suitcases to bring it with or to have it shipped to a certain address so it's there waiting for us when we get there.
One of the things that one of the duties that Jeff does very, very faithfully before we go on a tour or have any concert whatsoever, and sometimes even for rehearsals, is he sends us a checklist, and it's very detailed of exactly who brings what, who brings not only merchandise, but outlines exactly what clothes we're wearing, and even puts details like make sure we bring those little golden clips, and we have everything on that list so that nothing is forgotten. Throughout 20 years of playing together, we've had too many things that were left in places, and so, or somebody didn't have something with them, so. Details, every little tiny detail of the trip. Last time you even put on there.